from its recent failures to what it means for space travel as a whole and more. Join me as we explore the Starship SN3 failure reasons, SN4 already under construction. Without a doubt, one of the groups that are keeping the hopes of getting back into space alive is Elon Musk's SpaceX. Not only are they trying to revolutionize how we get into space via reusable starships and such, but they're also the ones who are pushing the hardest to try and get us to Mars. But to accomplish this goal, they have to put their starships through rigorous testing that pushes everything to the brink, and sometimes beyond. And through that, they can know if the starship will hold up or if something needs to be changed. SpaceX has been doing some recent tests in early April when something sadly went very wrong. SpaceX Starship SN3, the latest iteration of Starship test vehicles, was lost during testing at the launch site in Boca Chica, Texas. The incident occurred during proof testing one Friday morning. However, Elon Musk has since clarified the issue was the result of incorrect commanding resulting in the loss of pressure, as opposed to any material issue with the Starship build. As a result, SN4 will not require alterations to its structure, with construction work on the next Starship already taking place. To be a little more specific, the team was doing the various testings of the craft when they eventually went and did the much-dreaded cryogenics test. This is when they put in liquid nitrogen into the craft to test how the craft would hold up against freezing temperatures at certain pressures, mimicking the feeling of space against the craft's interior and hull. At first, everything seemed to be going fine. There were some small glitches, including leaks in the valves at certain points, but SpaceX determined it was okay to keep going. As they were filling up the top parts of the SN3 with liquid nitrogen, though, the whole thing buckled and thus the entire craft was destroyed. And if you look at the footage of the event, you'll notice that it broke down in rather mind-boggling fashion. However, SpaceX is confident that this wasn't a case of materials not holding up, but rather a command prompt going wrong in the test that caused the wrong parameters to go off and thus scuttle the craft. Elon Musk noted, "We will see what data review says in the morning, but this may have been a test configuration mistake." On Twitter and the first look observations, the fault may have been related to detanking or an out-of-spec pressurization status rather than another structural failure under pressure. This was later confirmed in later tweets, with Musk adding specifics as to the cause of the failure. "There are redundant pressure control valves. It's a new system, and SN3 was simply commanded wrong. Rockets are hard. Good news is that this was a test configuration error rather than a design or build mistake. Not enough pressure in the LOX tank ullage to maintain stability with a heavy load in the CH4 tank. This was done with N2. Not so ironically, this wasn't the first time that a SpaceX vehicle has failed in regards to cryogenics testing on a launch site. But the difference, though, is that the previous models failed due to the materials that were put on the craft. In this case, it was a command prompt that screwed everything up and not the materials. And that's why the upcoming SN4 won't need to be upgraded in the materials or construction sense. Or at least, that's the belief right now. This all could change in an instant or with the arrival of something new." Before we continue to break down the SN3 incident, be sure to like or dislike the video. That way we can work hard to bring you the best videos possible. Also, be sure to subscribe to the channel. That way you don't miss any of our weekly videos. As noted, SpaceX has been working on Starship vehicles for a while now. Not just that, they've been redesigning, improving, and testing like mad to try and make sure everything works. Even the SN3 is something that is the product of a lot of testing and iteration. While it may be serial number 3, there have been plenty of ships before this, including the MK1 and the MK3. Starship SN3 is the culmination of all these test articles. The vehicle was stacked in a new assembly building beginning in mid-March. The vehicle was rolled to the launch pad and lifted onto the launch mount on March 29th, pending final preparations and checkouts at the pad. The SN3 vehicle notably featured a new internally mounted deployable leg design, which is visible in photos shared by SpaceX CEO Elon Musk. Musk noted that the legs will be longer starting with Starship SN4. SN3 does not have a nose cone, nor forward or aft fins. The aerodynamic surfaces are likely unnecessary for the low-altitude, low-speed test flights planned for Starship SN3. Following the completion of cryogenic pressure testing, the vehicle was to be prepared for those test flights. A single Raptor engine was originally planned to be installed on Starship SN3, although it had since changed to using three Raptors that were to be installed the day after a successful cryo test. These Raptors will now be used on SN4. Here's another thing that I'm sure some of you didn't expect. While the destruction of the SN3 was rather catastrophic at points, Elon Musk has noted that some of the parts of the SN3 survived, and thus will be put on the SN4. As for what comes next, the SN4 construction was already underway, but now it's going to be the focus of SpaceX instead of doing dual builds like they were doing with the SN3 and SN4. And because of the focus of it now, you can bet that SpaceX is going to be working doubly hard to make sure that everything is 100%, so they can not only pass the cryogenics test, which is slowly becoming an Achilles heel of sorts for them, but also will finally be able to do a hop in terms of launching about 150 meters in the air like previous models have been able to do. One SN4 has already arrived at the launch site. The vehicle will undergo proof testing and be fueled for a potential static fire to allow SpaceX teams to monitor the vehicle systems. If the fueling tests are successful, the teams can then continue into a static fire test. If any issues arise during fueling, the teams can take corrective action before another fueling attempt. Due to the iterative nature of the test campaign, schedule changes and delays are highly likely. Only after a successful static fire test can Starship SN4 conduct a test flight, which would be a major step forward for the program if they're able to pull it off. SN4 was set for high-altitude flights, likely seeing a more complete Starship vehicle consisting of a nose cone and aerodynamic fins as well as multiple Raptor engines. The high-altitude flights would also include the first in-flight reignition of a Raptor engine. It is likely the path will be refined to involving SN4 with SN3's test objectives of completing a hop before SN5 takes on the high-altitude flight tests. SpaceX has a goal of an orbital test flight this year. Musk recently noted that he hopes Starship will have enough flight history to substitute for Dragon for NASA missions, including the cargo and crew Dragon V2 vehicles and the newly announced Dragon XL cargo spacecraft. The Starship vehicle and associated Super Heavy booster will eventually play a critical role in SpaceX's overarching Mars colonization goals. I'm sure some of you at this point are looking at all this testing and the procedures and many versions of the SN models that Elon Musk is making and are asking, is this really necessary? The answer, of course, is yes. Not only is this necessary, it's vital, because even the smallest components can cause irreversible damage to a ship in space and can potentially cost the lives of crew. Missions such as Apollo 13 and the Challenger explosion are great examples of that. The damage done to those vehicles was caused by very minor components that could have, and did in the Challenger, cost them their lives. There was also the Apollo 1 mission where a lack of understanding about pressure caused a fire to break out in the shuttle as the astronauts were inside and they couldn't get out. So just on a human level, these tests are necessary, but just as important, Elon Musk and SpaceX can't afford to have any of their starships fail in space for any reasons short of an event he could not control, like an asteroid hitting them. Why? Because of the optics of it all. You need to recall that not even two decades ago or so, the space program as we knew it was dead. NASA was not getting much funding. The desire to go into space was at an all-time low, and people just weren't interested in going into space because, what was the point? Elon Musk came along and tried to inspire the world again by saying that we needed to go back to the moon, that we needed to start getting people to Mars, and that he could help lead the way. So in 2002, he made SpaceX and started his long process to try and make better engines, reusable starships, and get us to space once again. And he's already had some success, including working with NASA to send certain craft to the International Space Station. But why does this matter in the whole failure is not an option thing? The answer to that lies in public perception. When it comes to NASA, they've had their fair share of failures over the years, but we've accepted them because of the uncertainty of space travel and construction in the fact that for every failure they've had a bunch of success. including the big one via Apollo 11 that took us to the moon. But with Elon Musk, he doesn't have that. He's proven that his process of making these ships can work, and he's making incredible progress that makes even NASA jealous. But he doesn't have the body of work to show that his craft will take people to the moon, to Mars, and beyond. Not to mention, Elon Musk doesn't exactly have the best reputation in the world. He's very much known as an eccentric, and will do just about whatever he wants because he feels that he can, and then some. Which is fine in a certain way, because that is the part of the reason SpaceX is so popular and powerful. He willed it into existence, and it's farther than just about anyone right now in the race to get to Mars. But should all this backfire, or if the first manned mission to space via a SpaceX craft fail catastrophically, you could argue that they won't be able to recover from it. And this was just another failure from Elon Musk. But let's look at the bright side of this here. While it may not seem it from a certain point of view, the failure of the SN3 and the final modifications of the SN4 is actually a good thing, because they were fully expecting the SN3 to work because of the upgrades that they did. But for whatever true reason, command prompt or otherwise, it didn't work. And now they know that there is a way a command can destroy the ship. Thus, they're going to fix that. As noted by Elon, rockets are hard. And they are. There are a thousand things that need to go right in order for a rocket to both launch successfully into space, stay there, and then complete its mission. These tests are designed to do checkboxes that will get marked off when something that could go wrong doesn't. The more tests, the more iterations, and the more failures they get, the stronger the next version becomes, until eventually they have a craft that is so prepared for space that it would take an external force, and not an internal one, to cause it to come down. Which in regards to the Mars mission is arguably one of the most important things ever, because while the moon mission was hard back in 1969, this will be infinitely harder. Not the least of which is because the distance to Mars is much greater than the distance from the Earth to the moon. Not to mention the first group of people will only have the ship to count on should things get hairy. There's no way anyone can rescue them. Thus, it's up to SpaceX to try and predict all the variables to try and compensate for everything that could go wrong, so that when the Mars Starship, whatever it may be named, is launched, they don't have to worry about a tiny part going and messing everything up. And should they succeed, should they get us to Mars and allow the first people to step foot on the red planet, then they'll have known that all the delays, all the hardships, and all the tests were worth it. Plus, once they do it, people will really trust them. And one of Elon Musk's biggest dreams will have come true, and no one will be able to take that away from him. Thanks for watching. What did you think of this look at the failure of the SN3 and how that will affect the SN4 and beyond? Do you think that SpaceX will make serious progress in terms of their rocket and Starship programs this year? Do you believe that they'll truly get us to Mars? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.